Hello, everybody. Can everybody hear me? Good. Good seeing you all back. Yes, I will talk about hardware security, and I'm assuming that this is a topic that all of you would like, given the name of this conference. So I want to start with a question to the audience. If you hear about security incidents in the media, would that predominantly be software security issues or hardware security issues? So who here hears more about software security issues? That's almost everybody. Is there anybody who hears more about hardware security issues? Maybe one. So that's what I would what I was thinking. So you might wonder, is there actually any reason to think about hardware security? Because everything that you hear about is software security. So in this talk, I will elaborate a little bit on how hardware security actually affects software security, and why I believe it may still be important to pay attention to that. So if you look at the attack exploitation space, I have an axis time versus distance. So on the horizontal axis to the right, you see very slow attacks. On the left side, very fast attacks. At the bottom, you see local attacks. This is where the attacker has the target in hand. And on the top, you see remote attacks, where the attacker can be far away from the target. Typically, software attacks, protocol attacks, they are relatively fast in the execution, and they can be done remotely. On the right-hand side, you see the more slow attacks. Of course, key brute forcing is slow. Side channel attacks tend to be a bit slow. Fault injection typically needs to be very local. And physical attacks, both local and slow. So these attacks are maybe not the most attractive attacks, because as an attacker, you need to be very near to your target and you need to spend quite a bit of time. In fact, you could say that hardware attacks require either the presence of hardware vulnerabilities or hardware changes to the target. Now, let's have a look at the motivation of the attacker. Why would an attacker attack a target? And I'm looking into the motives of an economic attacker. I know there's also nation states, and these are a different class of attackers, but here I'm looking at economic attackers that are really out for profit. So I was told that typically you lose the half of your audience as soon as you put a formula on, but since you guys are techies, I hope that you can survive this formula, and I promise you this is the only one. So there's a formula that I wrote down for the profit, the ultimate profit for the attacker. So there's a couple of parameters there. P stands for profit, everything that the attacker earns. The number N is the number of replications. How often can you repeat the attack? V is the value for each individual attack. So every time you steal 10 euros, then V would be 10. CV is the variable cost. So it's the cost that the attacker spends every time that he performs the attack again. And there's CV, the fixed cost. This is the cost that the attacker makes only once to invent the attack, if you will. So obviously, the attacker will be more motivated if P gets higher. So we'll be using this formula in a couple of examples later on to understand what makes the attacker tick, what makes him really happy. So there's three known attacks. So these are real attacks that have been executed in the field, and I happen to know a little bit about them. You will find details on these attacks on the internet, but it can help us to analyze the impact of this formula on this kind of attack. So the first one is a real hardware attack, a man in the middle for a banking card. So the attacker used a banking card and manipulated that card to get money from a bank account of the victim. The second one is a pure software attack. It's a retail attack where cardholder details were stolen and abused later. And the third one is mostly a software attack, a little bit of hardware involved. It's a relay attack to avoid paying pay TV subscription fees. So everybody wants to watch TV, nobody wants to pay for it, so there's an audience. So let's have a look at the EMV man in the middle attack. So on the top side of the slide, you see the normal scenario. If you make a payment in a shop at the cash register, then you would enter your banking card. Nowadays, all banking cards, at least in Europe, have a chip. And you would have to enter your PIN. The PIN that you enter on the PIN pad is sent to the card, and the card would say, is the PIN correct or not? And if it's correct, then you get the stuff that you wanted to have. Now, with a man in the middle, that you see in the bottom half of the picture, you could simply bypass that question, is the PIN correct? So the man in the middle would say yes for any PIN. And then he would tell the smart card that this terminal is unable to enter a PIN. So there is a class of payment terminals that do not allow, that do not have the facility to enter a PIN. So it would tell the card that this is a happens to be a terminal without PIN entry. And the card would accept those payments in specific situations. Otherwise, people could not use the card in those situations. So the man in the middle will simply bypass the PIN verification. So how was this executed? It's really a very technical attack. The attacker stole a bank card, and he actually made modifications in the plastic of the card. So this is the original chip in the card. And he did not make any modifications to the chip, but he added some electronics in there. And mind you, this is all in the plastic. So the card is only maybe 2 millimeters thick. So it is all extremely flat. So these wires are also very thin. So he milled a bit of space in the card, put the extra electronics in there, and covered it up again with plastic. So it looked like a normal card. But there is now a man in the middle, which is these electronics, that would say yes to any PIN. So from an electronic point of view, it is a very simple simple feature, but the challenge here is to get it in the card. So this attack was very very nice, very beautiful in my eyes. But in fact, it was not very successful because with these stolen cards, things were bought, and the cardholder, of course, started to complain. So the bank started to investigate. And they recognized a pattern where the criminal was buying stuff, and at some point the criminal was caught as he was making his purchase. So I guess the guy who stole the card did not have a lot of fun of his work. Let's have a look at the retail attack. So this is a bit of a complicated software attack, but let me walk you through it. So it starts with number one. This is where an attacker fishes some details, some secrets from a contractor. And the victim here, or the place where everything happened, was the Target, a big retail shop in the US. So Target has contractors that deliver goods, and they have to get access to a contractor portal where they do their registration. So this is a contractor doing some work. His laptop was compromised. So the attacker could use the compromised laptop to get into the network as soon as the contractor logged in to the network. Went to the Windows file server, infected it in a way that there was malicious software depatched to all the cash registers in the shop. So typically there's like 10 terminals there. All of them got the malware, and the malware would then inspect the memory of the terminal every time that a payment would be made, would collect the credit card details and the PIN codes being entered. All of that data would be sent back to this internal server. It would be stored here until exfiltration. This server would create a connection to an external computer that was owned by the attacker and dump all the credit card details there. So this attack was quite successful because it ran for several months before it was detected. So the attackers kept collecting data until they decided, okay, now we have enough. And then they started printing cards with that data and started spending. So there was quite a bit of spending, but ultimately also they were caught because, they were selling these cards in the streets. Then there's the third attack. It's card sharing. So this is a attack that has been very popular in the pay TV world. So how does this work? Pay TV decoders in the past used to connect to satellite dishes. This was before we had the cable networks, but essentially it's the same with the data coming in over the network. So they use a smart card, and a smart card has a secret key. The attackers were unable to break that card. No wonder, because these chips are typically the most secure available. But they actually found a bypass, because what happens, via the satellite connection, the cable provider, or the satellite provider, would send encrypted session keys to the smart card, and the smart card decrypts those session keys, and then is able to decrypt the video content. Now, those session keys are refreshed every so many minutes or hours. So even if you have a decrypted session key, you can only use it for a short time. So it seemed to be a pretty good method. However, the attacker discovered that nowadays everybody has internet, so why not distribute those session keys over internet? So the people using this system would still get their video stream through the cable or a satellite, but over the internet they would get the session keys. So this is a setup at one of those attackers. Within the PC they had a lot of slots that had subscription cards for all different TV channels. They were constantly picking up the information from the satellite stream, getting the session keys out, and distributing the session keys over the internet to the PCs of their members, their subscribers, which could then use a very simple connector. That's this one. It's just a wire connecting the PC to the decoder. So this was a massively successful attack case. Let's look a little bit at the use of the formula I presented earlier. So we have the three attacks, the EMV attack, the retail hack, and the card sharing. So if you look at the fixed costs, I believe this was highest for the EMV because there were physical changes that needed to be made for the card. For the retail hack, I guess there was some fixed cost to set up the whole infrastructure. The card sharing cost is actually relatively simple. It's only a bit of software and an adapter for every user. The variable cost is also for the EMV attack quite high, because for every stolen card, you have to make the same modifications. The retail hack was very cheap. The only thing that is a variable cost is the copied card, so the issuance of a blank card with the credentials. The card sharing is a little bit more expensive because you need to have that adapter. Now, if you look at the value, with a normal banking card, there's typically a limit that can be like €500. With the retail hack, the cards were actually sold in the streets, and people buying them, they would know that the card would be valid for a day and then it would be blocked. So they would typically pay €25 for that. Whereas the card sharing was more valuable, because if you would buy a card from a pirate, you would not be a criminal. It's not illegal to do that. You could keep watching your television channels for a long time, so there was more value in there. But the biggest thing here, the difference, is the number of replications. So redoing that EMV attack was very slow. It's very hard to do more than 100 times. The retail hack, there were 10,000 cards copied over some time, but 10,000, still much less than 1 million subscriptions for pay TV. So if you look at the ultimate profit, you can see the replications are really the most important part in making the attack successful. So how are these replications actually bounded? First of all, there's the application size, the number of potential victims. So if you are robbing people that bank at a certain bank, then the number of people that are banking there, it's your upper limit. If you are stealing wallets from people in a room, then it's the number of people. So this is the number of victims. There's detection and mitigation. So typically when an attack is executed, at some point it will be detected. At some point people start mitigating. If that is very soon, it will put a cap on the number of applications. And of course, the replication effort. So the more difficult it gets to replicate, the harder it is to keep making that profit. So these are things to keep in mind. So to determine the scalability, and the scalability is directly connected to the number of replications, we need to quantify the replication effort. So let's look a little bit at the attack phases and costs. Every attack has two phases. The first phase is the identification. The second phase is the exploitation. So in the identification, you invent the attack. In the exploitation, you keep repeating it. So identifying, you need only one vulnerability or maybe a few vulnerabilities that you combine. But for the exploitation, you need to repeat it. So you have to do that multiple times. For both phases, it's important how fast you can do that. It's important how much skill you need, knowledge, experience, what sort of equipment, and the location. So these aspects are all important. So the identification is typically the fixed cost, and the exploitation is the variable cost. Now, if we compare hardware and software, I filled in a couple of values there. Red means it's difficult, green means it's easy, and I've compared hardware and software. So the speed of identification is typically slow. Almost always, people coming up with a new attack spend quite a bit of time to invent that. But if you look at the exploitation, hardware attacks tend to be relatively slow, but software attacks tend to be very fast. Looking at skill, almost always you need an expert to invent an attack. But on the execution side, for hardware, you can do with somebody who's proficient, and software typically is a layman, somebody who can push a button. Equipment. Executing a software attack, often you don't need any equipment, as most a PC. Looking at location, remote location is of course most interesting because an attacker can reach the entire field without leaving his room. So I think it's quite clear that scalable attacks are very much connected to software attacks. Scalable attacks really need software exploitation. So I'm still not at a point where I can prove that hardware attacks have any relevance. But let's have a look at how software vulnerabilities are found. There's actually two ways, either black box or white box. Black box means that you have a device, but you have no idea how it works. You don't have codes, you don't have detailed specifications. Whereas white box, you do have a lot of information, at least binary codes, but maybe even source codes. So black box attacks include model-based testing. This is where you may have a specification or an idea about how a product might work. That's your model. And then you try to execute tests according to that model. But I would compare model-based testing like a blind person walking, because you don't know for sure whether your model is correct. You don't know where you're going. You don't know exactly what the product is doing inside. So it's very, very difficult. Fuzzing is a kind of attack that can also be done black box. If it's done black box style, it's like shooting blindfolded, because you don't know what the product is doing. You're just shooting, and you're shooting a lot. And by shooting a lot, you might find a lot of anomalies, but still, you don't really know what's happening. So it's the power of fuzzing in black box is that you can quickly find a lot of potential issues, but if they are real issues, it will cost you a lot of time. Then on the white box side, it would start with binary analysis. So this is where you have the execution codes. the code that runs on the target. And this is something that you can compare with a walk through the jungle. You have a big knife, a machete, and you have to cut yourself away through the jungle because you cannot see very far. But in your direct neighborhood, you can see what's going on. And this is often the attacker's method. Many attackers get access to binary codes. Even easier is a source code review. And this is something that I would compare to a walk in the park. You can look quite far. You can see where the roads are. You can see where the junctions are. It's easy to get oversight there. And this is the preferred defender's method. So this is all a bit simplified, because in some cases attackers can use this method, like when there's open source. Sometimes fuzzing is used in combination with source code review, so there is some overlap, but this is a simplification that works well for my purpose here, because I think the effectiveness really goes up from left to right. I don't know what kind of numbers you can attach here, but if this would take you 1 day, this might take you 10 days, 100 days, and 1,000 days. So most vulnerabilities are in reality found white box style. So if we listen, if we hear about vulnerabilities in the media, typically these vulnerabilities are found white box style. So the attackers have had access to some information. So what about vulnerabilities in source codes? And this is where I have a lot of experience in our company. We do a lot of source code review for customers, and we get to see a lot of software. Now, I'm assuming all of you are familiar with Moore's Law. So Moore stated in the 70s of the previous century that every 2 years, the number of transistors in a chip doubles. And Moore's Law is still valid today. Sometimes people say it will end, but it's still valid. So every 2 years, we're getting chips that are twice as big, twice as many transistors, twice as many memory cells. So the amount of software can also double every 2 years. So if the software doubles every 2 years, it grows tenfold every 5-6 years. So it's growing very rapidly. And maybe the older people in the audience can remember the first PCs that had like 100K memory. Now we're talking many gigs of memory. So if you look at applications, even applications on your mobile phone, they are like 100 megabytes. They're huge. So there's a lot of codes, and it's growing and growing. So when we do code reviews, we typically see products that are between 10 and 10,000 KLOC, 1,000 lines of code. So between 10,000 and 10 million lines of code. And what we see typically, the number of vulnerabilities is between 0.1 and 10 per 1,000 lines of code. So let's say on average, 1 per 1,000 lines of code. So if you have a product with 1 million lines of code, you can expect that there would be 1,000 vulnerabilities in there. 1,000. And this is not because it's not been tested. No, we've just not found all those vulnerabilities. So all products have vulnerabilities. And we should not be surprised when there's more and more reports coming out about vulnerabilities found in operational products. There are plenty of them. However, finding them, there's a challenge. So a manual source code review performs roughly at 100 lines of code per hour. So that means that finding a vulnerability in source code may take just 1 day. If you have to do that in binary code, it may cost you 10 days, fuzzing 100 days, etc. A bit of statistics. So a few words about binary analysis. I'm assuming some of you have done that in the past, and this is not a very recent screenshot. But with binary analysis, it's important to understand that you cannot really read, not easily read the code, like what it's doing. You have binary codes where you have to try to find your way around, but there's a lot of tricks there. So areas that are not used, they typically have a constant value. Areas that have codes for a specific architecture also have a statistical distribution, like some values will occur more often than others because of that instruction set. Areas where keys are stored typically have a very random content. So by doing statistical analysis, you can do quite a bit of reverse engineering, and it's really possible to work yourself through it, but it's just relatively slow. A bit of assembly here. Okay, so clearly there's a lot of vulnerabilities in software, and what people like to do is to hide those vulnerabilities. Of course, we all want to get rid of vulnerabilities, but we have to accept that they are there. Developers are human. Humans make errors, so vulnerabilities are there and will be there. So they're just trying to make it more difficult for their adversaries. So trying to hide software vulnerabilities. So what can you do there? If you deny the attacker access to the binary code, it will become much, much more difficult. So this is actually a trend that we see. If you look back at the age of the when a PC started, everybody using a PC was allowed access to the binary code, the .exe files. You could simply open an .exe file in a binary editor. Now, if you look at smartphone software today, typically the code is only visible if you root. So ordinary users have no longer access to the binary codes. And if you look at set-top boxes, so these are used for decrypting television signals, software is typically hidden and it's encrypted in transit. So even when they send an update, you would not be able to see anything about the codes. So they try to hide the binary codes, and they try to make it as difficult as possible for attackers. And of course, there may be parts open source, also in set-top box software, but typically there's also a part closed source, so attackers will have a hard time to figure out what software is in there. So how can we attack a product protected with software encryption? So the traditional way where you would do a binary analysis to expose a logical vulnerability and then use that knowledge to exploit and get runtime control, that wouldn't work anymore because there's no access to the binary code. The alternative is black box penetration testing. And yes, it does work, but it's painfully slow. So if you have no clue about what the software is doing, it will take you a long time before you find your vulnerability. Even if there's many vulnerabilities, it's not easy to find them. So it's not very attractive because it's a very long road. What might be much more attractive for the attacker? To have two phases, starting with a hardware attack to break the software confidentiality, to expose the binary code, and then use the binary code to find the software vulnerabilities, and finally to exploit those. So this is a much more attractive road. It has two steps. First, break the software confidentiality with a hardware attack, and then do a white box binary analysis to expose logical vulnerabilities. So we see this trend starting, and I'm going to give you one example. This is an example not done by us. It's there's a link under there, a guy named Frederick. He published this in 2016 already, but what was interesting, he did his work on a PayTV SoC, a system on chip, a very complex chip with a lot of security features in there. So it's a very secure design. So here's a design diagram of what this chip is doing. And what you see here is a couple of bootloaders. So typically you start with your first bootloader, then that bootloader would load the second one, and from there on you would go on until all the code that runs the box is loaded. And the first bootloader would be stored in ROM, it would be inside the SoC, but then you would start loading code from flash memory that could be outside the SoC, but it's encrypted. So as long as it's encrypted, it's fine. And the decryption is happening in the SoC. If you protect that decryption well, this can be a secure architecture. However, here the attacker used a hardware weakness to dump the bootloader image. So the first bootloader image was not accessible, was inside the chip, but the attacker was able to use a hardware weakness to dump that bootloader image. And how did he do that? Kind of magic. There's a photograph here of the PCB, and there's actually a sticker here with a barcode on it, and he started peeling off that sticker, and then below that he found this sign, RXTX GND. Anybody knows what that means? It's a serial port. Yep. Serial ports are typically used in devices for getting low-level access. So if you don't have a keyboard anymore, but you want to have keyboard access, you connect your keyboard to the serial port. So that's what he did. And he got basically access at root level here. So he was able to read the software that was already loaded. And he dumped this bootloader image and started to analyze the binary code in there. So he got access to the binary code. So that bootloader had a piece of binary code to load the next stage, the next bootloader. And there was a verification process that is very well known. It's using a signature, and the signature proves that the code is authentic, it's not been manipulated. So how does the process work? The binary code that's being offered for the next stage has a certificate and a signature. The process then starts by analyzing the certificate and finding a key that belongs to that certificate. That key can then be used to verify the signature, or actually decrypt the signature, and would get a verified signature that should actually be equal to the hashed code. So in the meantime, you can hash the code portion, get a hash, and then compare the two of them. If they are not equal, you would stop. If they're equal, you go, you load the next phase. So this is a pretty standard way of validating, verifying a piece of software. However, when he had this code in binary format, he started to analyze that, and he found inside the code a struct that defines the header that came along with the software package. And that header had a lot of variables, like how long it is, what kind of coding, what kind of certificate, where to find the key, etc. But there was one parameter that was called tsig type. And then he started playing with tsig type, and he assumed that this was to select the cryptographic algorithm to use. But he found that there was one value of tsig type where you would skip the verify phase altogether, get here, and then compare the signature with the hashed code. So what does that mean? That means that if you offer software where you don't have a real signature, but you would simply paste the hash in the place of the signature, you get through, and your software would be, your package would be accepted. Why is this there? Don't know, but this might be part of the development testing process. So the developer had been building this software, had to test it, didn't have access to a private key to sign the software. So okay, let's use a simple backdoor during my development to test my mechanism, and I'll remove it later. Never happened. So here the attacker used a simple, very simple hardware attack, then started doing a binary analysis, found his bug, his vulnerability, and now he's able to load any software on the device, basically meaning that he is in control. Okay. So the SIG type provides a backdoor that bypasses the verification. I'm arriving at the end already. So my conclusions here. Scalable attacks still need software exploitation. And this is because hardware attacks are laborious. However, software vulnerabilities are everywhere, so many of them. And software exploits are easy to replicate. So doing something to protect software is inevitable. And there's a lot of things that you can do. Software encryption is one of them. We see it getting more and more popular. At the same time, we know that binary analysis is quite successful in identifying vulnerabilities. There's more and more products that are using encrypted software. So when are hardware attacks scalable? When you need them. When you need them to get to your software attack. So this means the software is encrypted. And let's assume that there's no shallow bugs. So let's say the easiest bugs that you can find with your fuzzer, they're all gone. The hardware attack would be used in the identification step to extract the software. And of course, there must be deep software vulnerabilities in the codes. And in our experience, they are there. They just need to be found. So under some conditions, hardware attacks can be really scalable. And that, of course, means that hardware security makes sense. And everybody who is here, who is involved in making secure products, you have to step up. It's important that you do your work right. Thank you very much. And I'll be taking questions.
I have the microphone.
Thank you. I was wondering, what about timing? Let's say you have that replications of attacks over time. So what about the reactions? And, you know.
Sorry, I didn't quite get your question. Can you repeat that?
Yeah, I'm wondering about the time dimension in your formula.
The timing?
Yeah, time dimension. So it's over time, you can have more attacks, but if you react sooner, right, you would have less.
So, of course. Yeah. So time is a parameter that is important to the attacker, but also to the defender. So the attacker would like to be as fast as possible because he knows that sooner or later the attack will be detected and then the defender will start mitigating. So an attack that can be replicated fast is going to be more successful. In rare cases, it's impossible to mitigate. So these are the real beauties for the attacker because he can just continue. But in most situations, there are things that you can do to make the attack more difficult or even to catch the attacker. And yes, this is an important factor. This is one of the reasons that software attacks are typically more successful than hardware attacks, because a hardware attack just takes more time to replicate and you have to be local, whereas a software attack, when it's done remotely, it's being automated, you can reach a very high frequency. And even if they know that you're doing it, you are remote, so you might get away with it. Did that answer your question?
I think partially, in a way, yes. I was wondering about the SOC, right? That reaction part or the part needed to penetrate the system. So do you put a kill chain or anything on that?
Are you referring to the page fee example, the SOC that was broken?
Yeah, in a way, and also in your formula. So, yeah.
So typically, fixing software is so much easier than fixing hardware. So software, you do a patch and you're good to go. You just have to make sure that everybody's patching. And I think this is also where a responsible disclosure really works well, because with responsible disclosure, an attacker would say to a vendor, "I found a problem in your product. Please fix it, and I'll publish in maybe 1 or 2 months." And that will give the vendor some time to fix it and to install, update the software. With a hardware product, this is much more difficult. And as I said, in extreme cases, there's nothing that you can do. Then the product is just dead. there is a debate going on to what extent hardware attackers should publish what they find. Because if they publish, they may kill the product. But if they don't publish, then they may not help to drive security further. So it's an ongoing debate, I guess.
No questions anymore? That's it, I think. Thank you, Mark. Thanks for the talk.
Thank you. My pleasure.